everybody, and welcome to another exciting episode of the epic, awesome show, anime podcast number 71.
What number are we on?
71.
What? Oh my god.
Yeah.
We're that high already?
Yes, we're that high.
You know, next week I'm gonna be like, really, we're at 72? God, I feel so old.
So old, why? I mean, granted, you are old, but still.
I'm not that old.
How's you, whippersnapper?
So, this week is decently news here. I don't think there's a ton of news to talk about this week, but there is some new stuff to talk about for gaming-wise in Nintendo. So, if anyone has not heard...
Here we go, Zain.
Okay, so... Technically, actually, this came down last week, but I never got a chance to play it until this last week. And it was on the 29th, was when Nintendo's new flagship title, new IP, hit down was Splatoon. And I finally got a chance to nab a Wii U and actually play this game, and it is absolutely fantastic.
Go on.
It's an absolutely fantastic game because they have two different sections there. I mean, granted, I think the rank just kicked in when I started playing because I don't know how long the rank's actually been around for. Because originally when it first went on, the ranked actually was not unlocked for the reason why you had to be at least level 10 in order to do ranked. So it makes sense that because you need at least 8 players to be level 10. In order to actually do some ranked battles, because it's always 4v4.
Yeah.
But one thing that's finding interesting is that Nintendo did not have everything unlocked at the beginning of the game. So everything that they have in there, what they have right now is not everything that's not going to be in the actual final form of the game. Now... Granted, this is going to be a very great... a lot of people probably would like just roll their eyes at this and go, oh, crap, DLC, when they say, you know, they're going to release it out in DLC format. But I really wouldn't call it DLC-ish, because I'm kind of using quotations right now.
Patches.
Yeah, they're doing it in patches because it's free. And this is something that, you know, you pay a $6 game... And a lot of people are surprised that, you know, no one's complaining about it because it's free. Why would you complain about a game that's free? That you get free DLC for. And really, in all reality, it's a great, great game. So.
But Zain, why do people keep comparing to Call of Duty? Is this Nintendo's answer to Call of Duty?
Actually, to be honest with you, really, this is nothing like Call of Duty. This is absolutely...
You know I stole that for something, right, Giselle?
Yeah, I know.
Okay.
Yeah, but...
You don't have a beard, so I can't call you Beardman.
I see, okay. Sure. Whatever.
It's from The Completionist.
Sure. Now, granted, a lot of people before, they were saying that, oh, it's going to be the same thing as Call of Duty. And no, it's not, because kill count does not matter. Now, being able to kill players in certain matches actually can help you out to win. Because there's two modes right now. There is Turf Wars, which is in the non-ranked mode. And which basically is the... I'm trying to think here what it is here. Oh, yeah. It's basically where you have to spread the most paint. So whoever spreads the most paint in whatever territory is the winner. So it's just basically
and
that.
I'm guessing
it's
there's
just,
a limit.
What?
I'm guessing there's a time limit?
Yes, there's a 3-minute time limit. So each game goes by relatively quick. Like when we were just talking before, I went and played 2 games to see what the time limit was. And in that span of maybe 6 minutes or so, I did 2 games of Turf Wars.
Hmm.
So it's relatively very quick, very fast-paced, And the one thing that you can lose on this game is that you could be winning throughout the whole game, and you know a bunch of people on your team lose. That could easily be your downfall right there. Within the last minute, you could lose it. Because I have lost. I have been on teams where I've lost it, where we lost the game because it was just like we didn't have field presence, and our paint was just overtaken, and they just got back into the game within just that last minute. So with this game, it's never really one-sided. Sometimes, because I did get done doing a match that was very one-sided, two matches that were very one-sided, but usually, if you can keep it at a relative, depending on the what your team consists of, and that's the big downfall to this game right now, is that you have no idea what your team is going to consist of. Because every time you play, you're playing with randos. Now, granted, in the lobby, they have it to where you can actually play with your friends, but they have not yet to have it set for where it's to where you could be playing with your friend, or you could be playing against them.
So it's not really implemented yet, but it will probably be implemented in a later patch.
It will actually be implemented. They're going to be doing all the stuff throughout the whole summer.
Okay, that's cool.
Coming up June 20th and the 21st, they're having a Splatfest, where you basically pick a side, and then you go into, I think it's like some specialty turf wars, and basically whoever side wins gets like a specialty item or something like that. So, and it's like, it's going to be between like a dog and a cat type thing. And it's like, you just pick a side, which one do you like better, dog or cat, and then go in and have fun and play. And I believe that that's going to be in turf wars. Now, the other thing that they have unlocked right now is in ranked. And that is basically the, what is it? I'm trying to think, what do you call it? It's like the objective missions where you have to take certain objectives through paint. Like, I don't remember what you call them.
I'm trying to remember right now. Crap. I know what you're talking about, too.
Yeah.
But they're
basically where you have to take out control of a certain area, and then your time can go up or down. You know, your time goes down depending on the how long you have it for. Now, granted, there's a little catch to that as well, because even if your opponent goes down to like 7 seconds left on the thing, and you guys take it over, there is still a possibility you can still win the game, because I was on a team that choked. The last 7 seconds unranked, we were 7 seconds away from winning. The other team took it over. We could never take it back over, and we lost.
Ouch.
Yeah, that was frustratingly annoying. And I think once you get rid of the fact that you're playing with a bunch of randos in ranked, especially because there's certain consistencies in ranked that you can't really use as well, because my favorite thing to use, my favorite class to use in Splatoon is the roller class, basically. Because you have, like, three different classes. You have, like, the machine gun or basically spray and pray gun. You also have the charger gun.
From what I seem to understand, the roller class seems to be a favorite among a lot of people.
Yeah, the roller class is a very, very, very fun class. It's a relatively easier class to use. I'm gonna say it's not relatively easy class to use, because to master it, it takes a little bit of time. Because even I still probably haven't mastered the whole thing of the roller class. But there's certain things in ranked where the roller actually has a really good ability where you can actually put down what is it, like sensors or something like that, to where you can easily put down put down at least three of them, and you know other players hit the gamepad and actually can go right straight to it to these little I want to say like sensor type things. It's like little radio type things, little antennas, but like you know what I mean.
I think so.
It's basically where you put three, you can put three down, and then other players, or you can actually tap them on the actual Wii U pad and go to it. And then basically gets them right back into the game. Yeah. So, there is that, which is a relatively really good thing. And depending on the map, it really depends on the map you're at, and a lot of it depends on strategy as well. With the ranked battles, having to take the objectives has more strategy versus the turf wars. Because there's certain areas, like, there's a skate park one for the ranked ones that was relatively... I've had to figure out, okay, this is where these people are coming from, and I got to make sure that, you know, I can take care of them relatively quick. Because, yeah. Well, I'm using the roller class, and I have very short range I can actually use to take them out. So, like, literally being put on a side and figuring out where you need to be at each stage for each stage in ranked. I mean, granted, you can get relatively good at one stage. It's not hard to get good at, like, multiple stages in this game because every 4 hours it changes for two stages. Now, granted, yesterday was the only day that one of the few only days that that one of the stages never changed. And that was the Kelp Dome, because that Kelp Dome just went down yesterday. So it made sense that they kept it in all day yesterday.
Yeah.
So everyone can play it, you know, have fun, and check it out and see how it does. So there's certain stages I really like to be in versus Turf Mode. Even in the other mode. But, I mean, there's a few other modes that are coming in as well. There is the Tower Mode, where basically... if you are a roller class, it's not going to be a good thing. Like, for this mode, you're probably going to need a shooter class.
So each mode and level can play on different strengths and weaknesses per each class then.
Yeah, I would say so. I mean, the roller class is really, really good in Turf Wars because you can cover so much ground in so little time.
Yeah.
The roller class is not exactly as good in the ranked mode, but can be good if you use it right. Because one thing I noticed is that you have to flank enemies with the... You can't go head-to-head with rollers. With a roller, you can go head-to-head. Granted, you'll die, you'll both die, but you can still go head-to-head.
Mm-hmm.
But if you know on it, obviously you can't go head to head with a shooter because you'll lose every time because of the fact that you have no range.
Yeah.
So I mean, there's certain times where it's just like, yeah, the roller class really is not that good, but the Kraken that the roller class does have, and that's the second roller that you do get, you do unlock. I think it's like level 10 you unlock it, and it's an absolutely great. It's a great class. Now, granted, there's a few other ones that you can get, a few other rollers you can get, a few other weapons you can get through the amiibos that they have for Splatoon by completing challenges and stuff like that. So, I mean, there's a ton of stuff coming out for Splatoon itself.
Yeah, which is
stuff,
cool,
yeah.
Because Splatoon was one of those games, when I looked at it, I was like, this looks really cool.
Yeah, even when it unveiled last year at E3, we even talked to each other about this game and saying, you know, this looks like fun. This actually looks like a game that could actually really get me to buy a Wii U. And, well, guess what?
Exactly. And
it did.
You bought a Wii U.
Yeah. Because it was something really cool that they did with Nintendo did with Best Buy, is that they did a basically it's a download code for the Wii U. It's a download code that came with the Wii U and that had the Splatoon already put in, where all you do is download it and then you can play it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So it already had downloadable code that you had with it. The box looks really cool. I mean, I kind of wish the Wii U looked... The Wii U is just black. So it's like, eh.
Are all the consoles this generation black?
No. I think the Wii U has two different consoles, I think. I think it's white and black, I think. I'm not sure, because, I mean, granted, the Wii U, I think, is... I don't know if it's got another color besides black, but I mean, I was kind of hoping that it had the, at least the palette on it had a little bit of splatter on it or something like that. Because mm-hmm. it is the Splatoon Wii U.
But you were hoping for, like a kind of a Splatoon edition.
Yeah. One thing that's really cool that they put in here as well is that they put the, in each of your things, you have different clothing that you have as well. So each different clothing has an effect that it has on it, and then it also has another effect, up to four different effects. And granted, the first one you get is the one that you'll get all the time, is the one that is guaranteed to be there. The other two that you don't know, they have question marks on them, they're randomly generated.
Hmm.
So it's like, sometimes you get some, you can get some really good stuff for that. A few things, because it makes you stronger. You can get stuff that makes you faster and squid form.
Stronger. Faster.
Really?
What?
There's just so many different ways, so many different variants that you can do with this game that, you know, you can help your game out immensely. I mean, granted, if this ever becomes an actual eSport, it's going to be definitely a very strong game. I think what's going to help this game out the most is when they finally get the team implemented. Like, the same thing that... what is it? The same thing that, like, League has. And most, like, really good... even Call of Duty, even going back to Call of Duty here for a second here, has this...
Call of Duty!
...implementation where you can actually play with your friends. Versus whether or not you can actually play with your friends, you know, and actually go in as a group or something like that. And something else that's really cool, too, is that they're going to implement something as well where you can actually play... I don't know if it's going to be offline or not, but if it's going to be an actual offline thing or not, but to where you can get up to 8 of your friends and go into a custom match. And then you get to pick what stage you want to go to.
Yeah, kind of cool.
So you're not really confined to the two stages that are available within that four-hour time span.
Yeah.
Now, granted, the one thing I do have to say, though, that the one thing that's kind of annoying is that there is only two stages available every 4 hours, so it can get kind of monotonous going on to the same stages again and again and again and again. I never noticed it really getting too monotonous because you can go in between... ranked and the regular have two different stages, so technically four different stages are always going to be in play. So whatever's in ranked and whatever is in ranked is not going to be in the same stages that are going to be in the other one, except for yesterday where Kelpdom was in both.
And that was for players to try out, but you know, to really get in the hang of the level.
Basically, it was just the new level, and that way they could just, you know, bring it out. And granted, they're going to bring out a lot more stuff, and a lot more stuff for implementing, because they know they're having the tower defense one, basically, where it gets to the other side with a time limit as well. There's going to be other ones as well. There's going to be a few other ones as well. I don't think they have those. I don't think they have said anything. Give me a second here. I might be able to actually see that real quick.
So now that you have a Wii U, what do you think about getting Legend of Zelda when it comes out?
Yeah, it looks like just tower control there. There's going to be a few other ones, like Bluefin Depot, Camp Triggerfish is going to be another map that's on there. I mean, I could see why a few people were mad about the reason why... why, you know, Nintendo didn't release everything all together. And I'm actually kind of happy about that, though. because, you know, it helps them, you know, be able to stretch the game out further. And a lot of people who aren't happy about that are the people that, you know, buy games and then trade them in. And those type of people. Are the ones that just don't like it and all that stuff. But I don't know when they're going to actually be done with Splatoon, with adding new stuff to it, if they'll ever be done with it, though. Especially if it becomes an esport type game. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if they try to add, you know, newer stuff in there as well.
Well, always hope that they'll keep adding things down the road to keep the game fresh and not feel, as you said, monotonous.
Yeah, but definitely, it's a really fun game. It can be stress-free. There's a few times where you will get annoyed. I've gotten annoyed a million times on this game so far already.
Like the 7 seconds?
Yeah, that is frustrating in all its glory. But the one big thing, big downfall right now, the game lacks, is that you can't play with friends. You can't choose what your team is like. Because once ranked, especially if they want to get into the competitive scene, like where, you know, you actually have a team, you know, you're getting your team up and ranked and everything, and trying to get up there, become a really good Splatoon player or something like that, basically, there has to be a certain decoy of, or it has to be a certain number of X amount of players with various different... very different classes. Because most of the time I've looked at it and noticed that if you have a team full of rollers and the other team's a full bunch of shooters, it's usually going to not end well for the team with the rollers.
Because they can't defend themselves.
Yeah. Because basically the shooters can basically have their way with them, just get up high and then get away from the rollers. Unless you get into the Kraken form, then yeah, kind of. It can kind of easily get its way out, but that's neither here nor there, though, so.
So, Zain.
Yes?
Now that you have a Wii U, are you thinking about getting the new Zelda game coming out next year?
Maybe. It all depends on what's going on with, I don't even know, honestly, because, well, I have most likely going to be getting Smash Brothers 2, so.
Okay, because I did talk to someone who, has been looking into the new Zelda game.
Yeah.
And from what I understood, the new Zelda game actually has a lot of vibes that is very reminiscent to The Legend of Zelda 2, such as the leveling system and the open world.
Okay.
And in fact, when I saw the trailer for Legend of Zelda 2, I did not like it.
Yeah.
But then when I saw the gameplay for it, which was open world, there's different ways you can take to get from one location to another, it was like, wow. It actually looks really cool now.
Well, the thing is, though, is that I think we're going to find more on E3 this year. E3, I think, is what, next week?
Yes, and actually there's not going to be really anything involving Legend of Zelda for E3 this year.
Okay, which makes sense. Right now, their biggest game, as I said, Nintendo's biggest IP right now is Splatoon. It's one of their biggest ones. It's one of the biggest new ones, especially within the last 14 years. Because they haven't had a new IP within the next 14 years. That's a lot.
Well, wait, what? Smash Brothers was? I thought Smash Brothers was within the last 14 years.
But I mean their newest IP, though. Oh. They haven't had a new IP.
Oh, a fully original IP, not involving pre-existing IPs.
Exactly. Okay, you can't really say Bayonetta. Yeah. Bayonetta wasn't really a new IP for them. Granted, it was a good IP for them, but it wasn't a new one.
It's not a new one.
Those fully original start out in Nintendo. I mean, for crying out loud, they've been recycling the most of the same games over and over and over again. And granted, they're all great games. Still, like... Mario Kart, Smash Brothers, fantastic, phenomenal game. Mario Party, still great. The list just goes on and on with their games, because usually their games are solid. like, they do have their certain X amount of games, but they're very solid games, and this one is no exception. It's absolutely fun. It's absolutely fantastic. It really fits Nintendo very well, because it's not overly, it's not overly realistic.
Mm-hmm.
But it's very cartoony, but not too cartoony.
It has a good balance, is what you're saying.
Yeah, it has a good balance. Even when you put the paint down, it's like, the paint actually, like, certain colors look really cool. Because it has that nice shine to it.
Okay.
That you get with certain paint as it's wet and stuff like that.
Yeah.
It's just absolutely a fantastic game. I have no complaints about it, other than the fact that the certain things that it's lacking. As I said, one of the biggest things that's lacking is not being able to go in with your friends and actually play with your friends.
Yeah, some of the features.
Core people that you like to play with. Or be able to figure out, you know, hey, you like this class, you like this class, I like this class. You know, everybody has a different style of class. To be able to, you know, go into ranked and actually play against various other people. Mm-hmm. And get up levels easier and faster, because a lot of times is that you need to be able to talk to your friends or talk to people you're with, because that's the one thing that's, I understand why Nintendo doesn't have that at all, and that's because of, well, with the audio chat, you can't really keep people from swearing, and I understand that they want to keep it as family friendly as possible.
Yeah.
But I almost say if you want to get this game to be able to actually go to the next level, to where that's an eSport, it's going to have to go to that next. Probably going to have to get that audio chat in there, maybe. I don't exactly know how they're going to do it, how they're going to implement it, because, granted, they still want to make it to where it's like everyone has a good experience, and not, like, mm-hmm. you know, where someone's swearing up a storm and all that stuff when there's, like, little kids in there in a family-friendly game.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's their way of, you know, trying to control the online experience to where there's no swearing and everything else. But, I mean, with the ranked version, you do need to have that audio chat. So, in other words, you can actually, you know, communicate with your team. And that's the one downfall to the game that's otherwise a really fantastic game. If you guys have not played it and you have a Wii U, I definitely highly recommend this game. It's just absolutely a blast of fun. So, yeah.
All right, cool.
As I know, that took a little bit of time explaining everything. Sheesh. Sheesh.
Yeah, but it's all good.
Yeah. Yeah, because unfortunately we had surprisingly not watched any anime this week. I mean, granted, I've watched a few things here and there, but nothing too major.
Nothing noteworthy.
Yeah, I mean, I watched Cowboy Bebop, but I mean, that's Cowboy Bebop, and that's just awesome.
So there's no noteworthiness to that, because it's like, well, it's Cowboy Bebop, don't need to take notes. Let's throw the pad and paper away. And just enjoy Cowboy Bebop for what it is.
Yeah.
And then experience that ending again and be like, oh.
Oh. Hold on. There's something I wanted to grab too, real quick, before we continue on.
Alright.
It's one of our sadder news. Here. And I'm trying to get to it right now. Give me a second here. Oh, where are you? Oh, there you are. No! Back down, back down, back down, back down, back down.
I hated it.
Unfortunately, this happened, I think, yesterday, actually. So it's relatively really new. Unfortunately, Sir Christopher Lee dies at 93.
Yeah.
Now, if you're not familiar with him, he was in a ton of horror films. He was Saruman in The Lord of the Rings, and he was Count Dooku?
Yes.
In Star Wars as well. So, I mean, he was a great, great actor, in a ton of stuff that was very much, I would say, geek cult, nerd culture, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, he was involved in geek culture.
Yeah, but I mean, he was a James Bond villain.
He was also in Kingdom Hearts.
Was he in Kingdom Hearts?
Yes, he was Ansem.
Oh, wow! Talk about full circle.
As in Diz. Diz Ansem.
Ah, as I said, talk about full circle.
Yeah.
But I mean, unfortunately, yeah, it's kind of sad that, you know, he is now gone. But yeah, it's just like you'd think that he would just keep going because he was 93, and yeah.
And I actually thought he was gonna live on forever at this rate.
Yeah.
I mean, as you said, he was 93. He was involved in geek culture. He was in metal bands. And, you know, he was still acting, and it never showed in his performance,
yeah,
you know, the age or anything like that.
Because I know he was having some issues in the... I think he played Saruman in the new Hobbit movie as well.
Yes.
And he was having some issues then, but then it's just like... He found a way to be able to give his performance while not even feeling like, you know, he's hurt or anything like that.
Exactly. I almost forgot, you know, that, what was it, like 10 years passed between Lord of the Rings and Hobbit or something like that?
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's like, wow, I almost forgot, you know, how much time had passed between the two films.
Because it didn't feel like any time had passed.
Right.
Well, I mean, it makes sense that time wouldn't pass because technically it's in the future. No, it's in the past.
Yeah, but the way the actors were and their performances, it still felt...
Yeah.
They still felt there.
Yeah.
And I would have never expected, you know, that with Christopher Lee. It is very sad that he left the world, and...
Yeah. I mean, to be honest with you, he was... It's like one of those things that's kind of sad, though, that, yeah, he was 93, he was having issues. I mean, it's kind of nice now, the fact that... It's kind of a morbid thing to look at and go, yeah, he was up there. Granted, that's awesome, that's impressive, he was still acting all the way till he died. And that's really, like, I think everybody who gets into acting really wants to be like that, to basically where you don't retire from acting, you just keep going. There's no retirement. Even though he probably could have retired 10 times over.
Yeah, and, you know, gave it his all.
Yeah, and but what's really interesting and really cool, and I still find it very, I have to give him... very much so an applaud, is that, you know, he continued on even when he is hurting, because I would say most average people, if they were hurting and stuff like that, they probably would have, you know, given up acting and all that stuff. But I mean, it just shows you how much passion he has just for the craft itself.
And he was dedicated to,
yeah.
I mean, I think he is the second most well-known actor to play Dracula.
Yeah.
He played Dracula for, what was it, 10, 15 years he played Dracula in different films.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's pretty impressive that he played this role and kept at it for so long, and then expanded the roles he's done, you know, and like in James Bond, The Man with the Golden Gun, and then so far off in the future he did the Lord of the Rings films. He did The Last Unicorn, The Hobbit, Kingdom Hearts.
But what's really interesting, you know, too, is that, you know, you look at him, and he really doesn't look like he's in his 90s. He looks maybe in his 70s.
No,
I would say probably late 70s, early 80s, if
I
that.
I would be guessing that, yeah.
That would be roughly where I would say it'd be, like, he doesn't look like his age either, so I think... Maybe? He just didn't act his age, so therefore he wasn't his age?
Probably.
So I think that's the only way you can get your age, is if you act your age.
That's part of the reason why people keep mistaking me for my teens.
I see. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. But no, it's great, though, that now he is... he doesn't have any more... he's not in any more pain, no more suffering. Yeah, so... As I said, our heart goes out
but
to...
But he'll forever be immortalized.
Yes. And that's the reason why I still like the medium of... I still like, you know, visual medium and even audio medium. Because it almost keeps somebody who's dead, somebody who's just passed on, and it keeps them continually with us. Even when they're not.
Yeah.
Because we can appreciate what they've done, what they did for the craft itself, and, you know, how they worked and everything was just... It's just absolutely great. And, you know, he can most likely be an influence to many generations to come.
I hope he will, yeah.
So, as one of the greatest actors of all time.
Thank you, Sir Christopher Lee, for your service in the film industry.
Yes. Okay, so, after that moment of silence there...
Yes.
Alright, so, let us move on
here. Okay.
Now, Aniplex is actually going to release the first Aldnoah Zero season on Blu-ray and DVD with dub and sub. So, some of these are actually really cool. Aniplex of America, yeah, is it doing both dub and sub of Aldnoah Zero, which means, because this was originally came out when... This originally came out... I'm trying to think here.
Was it like last year?
Maybe it came out last year. Yeah, when it premiered in July 2014.
That's what I thought.
So, some of the big names that are coming on right now actually include Erica Harlatcher, Christina V, Erica Mendez, Bryce Papenbrook, Christine Marie Cabanos,
Bobby Thong,
Matt Mercer,
Thornton, Todd Hypercorn,
Patrick Seitz, yes, Lucien Dodge. I think that's about it. That's all the names that pop out to me. But it looks like it's going to be a really cool series. Granted, it still runs into the problem of it's still going to be a. It's actually relatively, actually not that bad. For 12 episodes, it's $40. DVD with some okay. The DVD will include some the same video extras and will retail at about $40, but the store price will be about $30. So this actually is going to be one of very surprisingly a very cheap anime from Aniplex for $30.
And that's just the DVD version.
Yeah.
The limited edition Blu-ray version will be about $75.
Yeah. But, I mean, that's... Yeah.
That's still cheaper than Sword Art.
Yeah. But, I mean, the thing is, though, is that I'm actually kind of surprised by just the DVD version itself.
How cheap it is?
Yeah.
I am surprised, too, when you said that. I was like, huh?
Which, I've never seen Aldnoah Zero. I might check it out with this release because it comes out on July 21st. And the second set on October 27th. So, pre-orders on both volumes start on June 8th. So, it's already available now. So, it's okay. Now available for pre-orders. So, I'm guessing it's about $60 for 24 episodes. It's not a terrible price. Not the greatest price in the world, but not terrible. Especially coming from Aniplex, because that's actually decently cheap.
Yeah, considering it's Aniplex, it is considerably cheap. Because normally they charge an arm and the leg.
Yeah. Still, definitely it's going to be a very cool, very interesting thing, because, I mean, granted, Bang Zoom did this, apparently this was one of the ones that Bang Zoom did, held open auditions for last year.
You're killing me, Smalls.
Yeah. No. Dubcast, English Dubcast revealed Bang Zoom to hold open auditions, Anime Expo this year. That's not a big, huge thing, because that's normal for them now.
Yeah.
granted, it's an awesome thing, but I mean, it's just normal for Bingsim to hold open auditions for at Anime Expo, because that's their biggest thing right now.
Mm-hmm.
That's the one that they've been doing, because granted, the first year I was going to go, I was like, yay, they weren't going to do, the first year I went to Anime Expo, it's like, yay, they're finally going to do the, finally get to go to, what was it before that, it was something else that they did at Anime Expo, Bingsim did.
They used to do Anime Expo Idol, and yeah, then Anime they Idol. Switched over to the open auditions.
Yeah. Yeah, and that was just, it was kind of heartbreaking, but then finding out open auditions is like, yeah! And it's one of those things that's just like, oh, that's so cooler. I don't know what's cooler, is that you actually be, to go in front of an actual casting director and actually, you know, do what you need to do there, and then hope for the best.
I actually find the open audition is a bit cooler because you do get to be in the you actually do go in front of the casting director, unlike Anime Expo Idol where you only get to make a demo and you have to pray, and that's if you win, and there's two winners, one for singing and one for acting.
Yeah,
but the winner only gets to make a demo and hope to get back with the open auditions. It's cutting the third, I don't want to say it's cutting the third party out because there is a third party, but it's kind of cutting the fat out.
Yeah.
And going straight to the point, which is why I almost prefer that way. Here's some interesting news, Zane, for a game that's coming out. Kickstarter fundraising campaign for Bloodstained Ritual of the Night, the new game by former Castlevania producer, reached a stretch goal of $3.5 million. For the PS Vita version on Friday. Now, that's been updated since then.
Okay.
It is now at $4,830,595, and it is going up right now.
Sheesh.
And with 10 hours ago, they're at almost close to their final stretch goal.
And what's that?
Roguelike dungeon mode, which is at $5 million.
And how far are they away now?
Well, let's see. That if they're at 4,830, so less than 170,000 away to reach their 5 million goal.
Jeesh.
And it keeps going up. I'm watching it, and it's like clockwork right now.
Yeah.
And I believe it's been said that Bloodstained is now the most funded Kickstarter campaign to date.
Yeah. So, actually, what's interesting as well, too, is Maryland Governor Larry Hogan took a trip to Yamanashi to try out Japanese record-breaking Magvel magnetic levitation bullet train, traveling with him were executives from Baltimore, Washington, Rapid Rail LLC, who, after enjoying a 27-mile-long ride, headed back to Baltimore with the intention of bringing the technology stateside. There is no question that this is the future of transportation, Hogan said. The train can travel upwards to 374 miles per hour, but maintain a speed of 314 miles per hour for Hogan's trip.
Holy crap.
Governor Hogan announced that the state Maryland applied for grant for $27.8 million in the Federal Railroad Administration funds. The Japanese government will heavily back the project with a reported $5 billion as well as private investors. It does not require funds from the Maryland Department of Transportation, Maryland Transportation Trust Fund, both MDOT and Maryland Economic Development Corporation are co-appliance for the grant on behalf of BWRR. The FRA has turned down Maryland's request for funds in 2010, stating a maglev project was not ready. So, I think this is really cool. So, the funding was specifically to bring maglev technology to the United States, including from Washington, D.C. to Baltimore. Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe also already announced that his desire to financially support bringing maglev to the U.S., including a line from New York to Washington, D.C., and spoke with California Governor Jerry Brown to set up a high-speed railway from L.A. to San Francisco. and is pushing trains to link Houston and Texas. Okay, that's weird, but that's a really weird... but, I mean, if it's something that they're going to do with this, though, to link all the major cities in Texas and, like, all the major cities in each different state, that is absolutely fantastic. And I want to see this now.
Trains have leveled up.
Yeah, but, you know, this is just really cool because what it could really do, especially if it's cheap enough, a cheap enough alternative to be able to go to, you know, cheaper than, it could be something that could give, I would say almost airplanes a ride for their money.
Oh, yeah. Especially since this train here, oh my god. 374 miles per hour?
Yeah. No, 307.
That's insane.
It can get up to, yeah, can travel upwards
travel
of...
Travel upwards, 374 miles per hour.
That's a lot of miles.
But can maintain the speed for Hokin's trip, 314 miles per hour, but which still, is insane.
But still, 300 miles is still a decent amount of track.
Yeah.
Very, very, very good mile track, because I think, what, to go from coast to coast in the U.S., it's about roughly, I would say, maybe 2,000 some odd miles.
Something around there.
And granted, if you can go from coast to coast from each major city to L.A. or something like that, it could actually take possibly less time than a plane would. Maybe.
Around there, yeah. I would say it's about a little less time than a plane up, I would take a guess.
Yeah, because, I mean, you have to think, too, with planes, you have to deal with the coming in and going. Having to wait to actually go and everything else. With this, you don't have to... You probably still have to wait for the coming and going, but the thing is, the planes can actually go a little bit faster, too, because they can kind of go in that straight line. And trains don't really have that thing. They kind of are, you know... Oh, they can kind of go in a straight line.
They're wobbly.
Yeah. But how much it actually would work, how much it would be really great to have that technology stateside, and especially even just linking up, at first, just linking up, you know, going from major city to major city, like from San Jose to San Diego to Los Angeles to San Fran, like, that would make it, like, 10 times more... Nice.
Oh, yeah.
Because you can at least have it all linked up together. And, like, same thing in Texas, because really their major cities, the three major cities, are Houston, Dallas, San Antonio, and Austin. And they're all right next to each other. Like, literally within at least maybe almost two hours maybe within each other. So with that type of train, it, like, makes it to where it's, like, maybe commuting could actually be a lot easier if you needed to commute to, like, from Houston to Austin or... And it all depends, too, on how much the actual train costs to actually...
Yeah.
And
I mean,
gonna depend
I can't imagine
that,
it
though.
Being too cheap, but I can... But it'd be nice if it's not freakishly expensive.
Yeah. That's gonna be the biggest thing is that it's gonna be... How much is it going to be? Because if it's a lot of money, because right now trains are ridiculous, are 10 times more money than riding a plane.
Oh yeah,
because I've looked at it going from coast to coast on a train because I thought it'd be kind of fun, and it's more expensive to go on a train to go to LA than it is to hop on a plane, and you're on the plane less time.
Hmm.
So it's like. You spend more money on a train ticket, and it takes you more time to get there. So it's like, it's just not worth it.
Yeah, I mean, it's about the price, and then whether or not the price can accommodate for the how long it takes to get there, and sometimes it's not really worth having to spend the extra money.
Yeah,
and just go the other route.
Yeah, but I mean, granted. With this, though, with this technology that's coming into the U.S., most likely is going to be coming in, I would say maybe within the next 2 years. If not, maybe sooner. But
it's a possibility.
All depends on when they get the funds for it.
Yeah, the go-ahead and how long it takes for them to start the construction, plus building, plus planning.
Yeah, because I would say mostly if they're going to do it in different states, most likely they'll probably use this in I would say maybe the top five states that they would probably do it in is going to be definitely in Maryland. It's going to be a definite state because, well, it's a Maryland governor.
Yeah.
New York is definitely going to be another one that I think they would try to link up.
Texas?
Texas is definitely a strong candidate. California is a very big candidate. And then the last state, I'm not 100% sure what they would try to do. Maybe they would try to link up the maybe the New England states together. I don't know. But like really what they've talked about is pretty much the big three, or the big four, I would say, is Maryland to D.C., New York to D.C., but it depends on if they try to actually do the whole entire state of New York, though.
Mm-hmm.
Or if they're just talking about going from New York City to D.C., because that's a big difference right there.
Yeah, it is.
Because it's just that's less distance. And I don't know how much, you know, it's going to cost to put down this type of track. I'm guessing it's going to cost a ton of money. But knowing that the Japanese government is looking to help us out with this, is that, you know, it's like, oh, hey, yeah, they're going to give us some money to actually, you know, build these tracks, build these type of tracks, because I think it will become a staple.
Oh, yeah.
I think it will become a future thing, because it looks futuristic. It looks cool. It just looks cool.
It does.
I mean, to be able to be on it and just take off, it'd be like, ah. Especially if it's going to be cheaper to go on that than planes, because then it would mean that a lot more people are going to be going on planes than planes, and then that means that plane tickets should wind up actually going down in price because they want more people flying. So it's like it's almost like a win-win situation.
Yeah, the only thing that kind of makes me wonder,
yeah,
is safety precautions.
Yes,
I wonder what kind of safety precautions they're going to take, because with speeds like that, it's going to be hard to stop a speeding bullet of a train.
Well, it is basically a speeding bullet, especially the way it's shaped. I would say they would probably have some safety precautions on there, but I mean, there's only so many things you can do with it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it'll still run into the same problems as probably some of the stuff that normal trains face.
Like derailment and...
Yeah. But I mean, it'll be designed to actually go that. The track itself will be designed to actually go from those speeds, so... So I don't think you'll see as many derailments, especially because it is magnetic. Because it's used magnets, so it's like, so it's not really attached to the track as well, as much as you think it makes any sense?
I think so.
It's actually more attached to the track than actual trains are.
Because trains use as wheels, this uses magnets.
Yeah, exactly.
So I'd say derailment. So think a little bit of Minecraft-ishness.
Yeah, kind of. So derailment, I don't think would be a big issue because of the magnets itself, so.
Okay.
I don't know the logic.
Science.
The science behind it. Thank you. Not the logic, but the science behind it. I don't know the whole thing of that. So, unfortunately, do not know that. But I'd love to see this come to the States.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely love it, because it would make it so much easier, especially if you wanted just to go to especially if they made it just cheap enough to go to for, like, the week or something like that, to go to the West Coast for a few days. And it was cheap enough to do that, and you're just like, yeah, just go. Have fun.
Yep, and then we'd be like, hey, Zane.
Yeah.
Ready to do some con stuff? Yeah. All right. Let's go.
One thing that's really cool, too, it's coming out now, other than the trains, because that train is just really cool, though. Not going to lie, that train is still cool.
What about planes and automobiles? It is.
That's not as cool as that train. So... Capcom has just announced on Monday that it will release the first 6 Mega Man games digitally on PS4, Xbox One, and PC this summer as the Mega Man Legacy Collection. Nintendo 3DS version will also launch this winter. A version will cost $15. So that's not terrible.
No, it's actually a pretty good price.
Yeah, so the addition of the six games download will include Challenge Mode, which mixes the stages from the games with a variable difficulty and a Museum Mode, which is a gallery of Mega Man history and art. The franchise began in 1987 and since spawned numerous games and several anime adaptions. So it looks like Capcom's trying to use a little bit of Mega Man by re-releasing some of their games.
Well, I'm thinking, call me a conspiracy theorist for this one. I think they're trying to kind of compete against Mighty No. 9 with the original Mega Man games.
Yeah, but to be honest with you, I still think it's a really cool thing, even if they're trying to compete against it. It's just a really cool thing for fans, because not only can you play the old Mega Man games, but then you can play Mighty No. 9.
A.K.A. the spiritual successor of Mega Man.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's like, it's kind of like a win-win. Because really, Capcom, if they're really going to try to compete with Mighty No. 9, they have to come up with a new Mega Man game. And not just re-releasing old Mega Man stuff.
And we all know that that's going to happen.
Yeah. But I'm just saying, anyways, though, that if they really were wanting to compete with Mighty No. 9, I don't think it's anything that they're trying to take anything away from Mighty No. 9 at all. Because I don't think they can at this point, because it is...
He gained too much momentum.
Well, not only that, but it's the creator of Mega Man. So it's like, really? How can you compete with that?
That's true. Here's some interesting news, though, involving Japan, though.
Okay.
The needs of Japan are continuing to shrink in number. As of 2015, the population of NEETs have gone down by 30,000, and now a total of 560,000, according to a recent government cabinet meeting. That marks the second consecutive annual decrease among the number of NEETs in Japan. Japan's Ministry of Internal Affairs and Communications estimated the number was near 630,000 in December 2012, with women making up almost 40% of the total NEET population. Hmm. Consequently, the unemployment rate in Japan among people 20 to 24 years of age is currently at 6.3%, while the unemployment rate for those 25 to 29 of years of age is 5.2%. This is the lowest unemployment rate has been among these groups since 1997.
Yeah. Which is actually really good, though.
Yeah, I mean, it's gone down. So that was one of the things I thought was really interesting, that Japan's now trying to start picking themselves back up.
Yeah.
And with different jobs and different, you know, whatever they can to make sure that the NEET population kind of dips. Because, you know, there's a lot of people who are NEETs in Japan. And unfortunately, I'm a NEET too. But anyways, But yeah, it's actually goes almost straight into the other one. Bit of news I found that was interesting.
It was that
Studio Arms is looking for production assistant and lists 145,000 yen monthly salary. So, anime lovers, Animation Studio Arms has an entry level production assistant opening for anyone willing to work for about $1,150 a month. Production assistants will work closely with directors and producers to meet production deadlines. The job listing states that those starting as production assistants get acquainted with the entire process of creating anime and can move up to become directors or producers. The company is seeking applicants with a strong desire to create anime, especially those who like the anime from the old days.
Huh. Now, I'm just going to go off on a limb there and say most likely they're probably not going to take any applicants outside of Japan.
Probably not, but at least this will also help with a little bit of the NEET problem, I would think. And it's a good thing, too, they actually are bringing more people, especially if they were looking for people who like the old-style anime.
Mm-hmm.
Say, Dragon Ball, Sailor Moon, Gigantor, Akira, you know, just older animes like that, I would think they're referring to. And I'm kind of curious to see how, with these new people coming in, what can they offer up to help with creating the anime in the future?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Which I think it would help out a lot anyways, because it's going to give you a different, maybe a different spin on something you may not have thought before.
Exactly.
And that might be something there too. Now, what's something really interesting as well is the Chinese Ministry of Culture announced on Monday that it has blacklisted 38 Japanese anime and manga titles from distribution in China, online or in print. So some of these big titles include High School of the Dead, Parasite,
Sword Art Online 2,
Strike the Blood, Attack on Titan, Psycho Pass, High School DxD, Girls Bravo Second Season, Black Butler, Dance of the Vampire Bun, and so much more. If you guys want to check it out, Death Note is also along with there as well. If you want to check out the full list, I'll have a description in the actual thing below to the link of this article that you can check out all the lists that, if you're in China, unfortunately, you're not going to be able to watch any of this.
Or read it.
Yeah. So, that kind of is kind of odd, but I mean, Senior Ministry official Liu Kuang stated the list is a result of evaluations by investigators, reviews by the ministry, and opinions of experts. It aims to guide websites in the proper review and important importation of comics and animations. Liu also stated that more titles will be added to the list. So, what exactly are they using for their guidelines? I have no idea.
Here we go. As of April 1st, new regulations in China require video websites to seek approval to stream foreign media. At the time, the ministry began blacklisting titles that include scenes of violence, pornography, terrorism, and crimes against public morality.
See, certain things, I don't understand why Sword Art Online 2 is on that list, though.
Probably it was due to the violence and slight sexualization of the characters.
Maybe? Slight.
Because it says violence, so basically they're not allowed to watch anime that are violent.
But that's just half the anime right there.
Exactly. I think China really does not want, unless it is completely kid-friendly, they have no intent of showing anime in that country.
So it kind of sucks for anybody who's into anime then, in China then.
Yeah. So I'm thinking Fullmetal Alchemist, Dragon Ball, those are going to be Gundam. Those are going to be
the big staples. Band. Cowboy Bebop is going to be Trigun. A lot of the really good ones, because especially like Psycho Pass. Psycho Pass is an amazing series. If anyone has not checked it out yet, have you checked it out at all?
No, I have not.
It's an absolutely fantastic anime. And it looks at a lot of different things, basically of saying that, you know, of following what a computer is telling you. And whether or not, you know, you should shoot somebody based on what the computer says.
Hmm.
And it's like, it's great. It's an absolutely fantastic anime. Just a great, great overall series. And
I was going to say, well, if you're going against what the computer is telling you, then it probably falls under crimes against public morality and violence.
It definitely is a lot of violence in it. There is terrorism in that as well. So that could be issues with that as well. But, I mean, Psycho Pass does bring up some great points in the series. Still very, very good series. If anyone's not checked it out, it is available on Netflix and on the Funimation app as well.
All right, so this next bit of information is going to be a little bit more lighthearted, I think. And by a little bit, I mean a lot of it.
Okay.
is that I'm going to combine these three, these next three news articles together.
Okay.
And it involves Tales, my favorite Japanese RPG series.
You don't say.
Yes, I know.
I can't believe that in a heartbeat.
To really help celebrate the whole Tales 20th anniversary, is the fact that Tales of Vesteria is now getting a PS4 and a PC version only in the West starting in October.
Huh.
The Japanese only got the PS3.
That's weird that it's getting a PC version.
It is. And Tales of Vesteria is not just getting ported over the PS4 and PC, but is actually getting a brand new anime series.
Huh.
Which comes out next year.
Nice.
To celebrate the 20th anniversary. And another Tales thing is that Hello Kitty is now partnered with Tales. Bandai Namco Entertainment announced that Sunday's Tales of Festival 2015, that is Tales of Game franchise, is the latest one to link up with Hello Kitty.
That's funny.
Hello Kitty's everywhere, which is why it's probably the only Sanrio is like the only company not in trouble because of Hello Kitty. They just like, here, sponsorships, join us, so we all have money.
Yeah, I mean, well, whoever created Hello Kitty is, you know,
a genius.
Is absolutely freaking fantastic genius. I mean, especially granted, there's a few things that, you know, geniusness comes along, like whoever created Friday is an absolute freaking genius.
Friday as in the movie or as in the day?
As in the song. It's so bad. But how many times did it get played versus people use it? People making fun of it? Making tons more money? You have to admit, it was a really stupid thing, but it was ingenious.
Oh, and the Tales of 20th Anniversary animation is the animation studio doing the anime for it.
Mm-hmm.
Ufotable. So the studio that's been making the animation for the last 3 to 4 Tales games, plus Tales of Fantasy, plus I think the Tales of Symphonia anime they did. So yeah, they're going to be working on this. And oh, here we go. There's an update involving it. The anime. .jp website initially reported that the anime is an adaptation of Tales of Vesteria. Okay. But it updated its articles so that it only states that it's an adaptation of the Tales of franchise. Bandai Namco Entertainment also characterizes the anime as a Tales of project and not an adaptation of Tales of Vesteria specifically.
Hmm.
So, I'm not sure what that means. Especially if the only one you're really seeing a whole lot of is Sore, the main protagonist of Tales of Vesteria? Not sure?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't know.
But yeah, I'm gonna get Tales of Vesteria for PS4 now. And play the crap out of it. And you'll never see me again.
Yeah. Also, what's interesting too.
I'm playing you with Splatoon.
Yeah. Also, what's interesting, too, we got some new anime coming on the 1st of July. So, Gangsta Anime TV debuts on July 1st. So,
yeah, what's that one?
That one is the manga revolves around Nick and Warwick, two men who take on jobs from both Mafia and the police in the town of Uragastulum. A rotten town filled with mafia, hoodlums, and prostitutes and dirty cops. So, it sounds interesting. It sounds like it's going to be gory. It sounds like it's going to be kind of cool. It sounds like it's going to be one of those series that China is not going to get, but...
What series is this?
It's the Gangsta.
Oh, I read some of the manga for that.
It looks like it's going to be interesting.
I really like the art style they use in the manga.
Yeah.
And I'll just say this, the guy with the eye patch,
mm-hmm.
he's a gigolo. The guy with the other guy?
Yeah.
He's deaf.
Yeah.
And the girl?
Yeah.
Is a prostitute.
Oh, yeah.
So, you're going to be seeing a lot of crazy things. Oh, and their favorite cigarettes is Pall Mall.
Well, everyone's got their
favorite brands.
Yes.
But I find it interesting that they actually used more or less American. It's very Americanized for
really?
Something made by in Japan, which
is it on the reminiscence of Cowboy Bebop?
I haven't read a whole lot of it, but I wouldn't really want to try to compare it to Cowboy Bebop though. Because yeah. It's Cowboy Bebop is kind of like that futuristic,
well, Cowboy Bebop American is more setting. Of a Western, sci-fi Western.
This is more of like an action,
yeah,
action Western.
Yeah, but the thing is, what made Cowboy, which is gonna be interesting, is see if they do the same thing as Cowboy Bebop, where they, what's the word I'm looking for here? There's a certain word I'm looking for, and I can't think of it right now.
Westernize?
Not westernize. Basically, their opening theme is like the same thing they did with Cowboy Bebop, or through the whole thing of Cowboy Bebop, because...
Oh, the jazz music?
That's the reason why I think most of it was like very westerny, is because, well, when Cowboy Bebop played, it was just like... It was very westernistic.
Well, here's the interesting thing, though, too, is that... The composer for Cowboy Bebop and Samurai Champloo is composing the soundtrack for this show.
Okay, so it's going to have a very Western feel to it, because Samurai Champloo also had that very weird feel to it. I absolutely love the music for Samurai Champloo.
Because I remember it was how, like,
hip- absolutely fantastic.
I very much remember, like, the very much the heavy hip-hop
feel to
feeling
it.
The Samurai Champloo had, and it was just stuck... to you, and it was right in your face, hip-hop. I was like, oh, God.
But it was just... It was crazy. Great, though.
It made it very unique, and it made it stick out from other anime. Yes. I never finished Samurai Champloo.
Absolutely fantastic anime. Definitely worth it. Definitely one of those anime that will keep you going on and on and on. So, unfortunately, I think that's all the time we have. I think we may have gone over. I'm not sure.
Tails!
Yay! So Yay! If you guys are interested in the new Mega Man game that's coming out for the PS4, or even want to check out the new Splatoon game, definitely check it out. I'm hopefully maybe within the next few weeks or so. Maybe it's starting next month. I'm going to probably start live streaming Splatoon.
That'd
doing
be cool.
A bunch of live streams of Splatoon, you know, getting people
welcome,
trying to get the hype. What?
You're welcome, Zain.
Yeah. Just trying to get more and more and more hype for this awesome, awesome game. Definitely, unfortunately, we're not as heavy on anime this week, which is kind of odd and interesting at the same time.
Yeah, it is. Well, it's because a lot's been going on with Splatoon, and
yeah.
I've been kind of busy with real life stuff, so I don't have a whole lot of time
right
to...
Well, right now it's like kind of one of those spots in the season where it's like, yeah, we can only talk about the same series as so much.
Before people are like, okay, we get it.
Yeah, it's annoying. Before it gets really, really, really annoying. Unless something major happens in the series, I don't think we're probably going to be talking too much about the anime that's in the series right now. So, So I'll definitely keep you guys informed on what happens with all the different... with all the different stuff that's happening in Splatoon, definitely keep you guys updated on that and, you know, see whether or not it goes to get better or if it just gets worse.
Yeah.
So, thank you guys again for watching. This has been Zain and...
Scotty Oka.
And remember, we'll see you guys on the flip side.
Catch you later, everybody.
Bye now.